Welcome, and thanks so much for joining us. I'm Pat Mungovan, Senior Vice President and General Manager for Oracle's North America Government and Education Business, and I'm absolutely thrilled to be joined by a luminary in the technology space, Clara Yelenkova, CIO of Harvard University. Welcome, Clara. The impact of the pandemic on education, both as a product, so sort of the delivery of education, as well as the experiential aspects of education. And thinking about that, I think, you know, directly, Clara, in your role as CIO, what are your experience and observations?
Thank you. And you know, it's a very interesting question, because one of the things that we learned was there has been a discussion, you know, ever since, you know, MOOCs burst onto the scene, whether or not we can deliver education online and how effectively. And what we have realized is that we are very efficient at delivering education online, save for, you know, special cases such as labs, you know, theater performances, you know, ballet, music, etc. But there's much more to a university or educational experience than just delivering education. And really what we are doing is a 360 holistic view of the student, not just student supports, but, you know, different opportunities that students have to participate in clubs, meet people, be part of a bigger ecosystem, and, you know, live independently, you know, figure out who they want to be. The more you go into undergraduate education, you know, high school, middle school, you know, K through 12, I think there's much more of a developmental process that happens in going to school that is not that, you know, where online just simply is not the same as interacting with people and being able to learn social norms and try things out. And I think that's where I think the online space has not been as robust, and in some ways is going to be interesting to see as we come out of the pandemic, or if you will, once we embrace it as more of an endemic, to see what has actually happened to students and to especially young kids that have been, you know, schooled at home essentially for, you know, 2 years.
So I speak with CIOs frequently, you know, several times a week, and each one has experienced the pandemic and sort of the challenges that they have in a unique kind of set of ways. What were your experiences like as the CIO and working through some of the challenges that folks have on the education side?
One thing that was that I was just struck by, you know, once you kind of get your head a little bit above the water and, you know, take more of a 20,000 foot view, is how incredibly well the technology staff and actually the technology platforms have performed. So I can tell you when I was on, you know, I was on calls and, you know, February, March 2020, and people wondering, well, is the internet going to melt down? Right. And, you know, I mean, there were articles actually asking that very question. And I think we need to step back and realize we have spent, many of us have spent 30, 40, 50 years building something. And when it came to a true test of it, it actually, you know, yes, there were complexities, but it actually delivered what it needed to deliver when people needed us most.
It's astounding how resilient and durable both the mission and the technology has been. Not perfect by any stretch, but extremely resilient in the face of substantial complexities. When I think about cloud, one of the great differentiators is that it unlocks environments so that, you know, now we're forced to be, even though I'm sitting 8 miles from you, you're in Cambridge, I'm, you know, outside of Cambridge, it's still sort of distanced by the pandemic. But what cloud allows folks to do is work from, you know, Geneva to Cambridge and Cambridge to Berkeley and Berkeley to, you know, University of Michigan and all these areas and all these experts and connect folks around the world. So what do you see on the research side and cloud is sort of an enabler for access and collaboration?
Harvard has a cloud first strategy, and I think a lot of R1 institutions do. It would be very difficult to build the global infrastructure that we need today in order to operate from within a campus, right? So that's where kind of globally spanned cloud infrastructure is a necessity for, you know, major research university. I think the piece that is interesting and we need to think through is we still have what is often referred to as a last mile problem. And I think it comes to forefront more in the educational space, where as students in 2020, as students disperse to go home, we have realized that we controlled the educational experience within the university network, let's say. But once they went into locations that perhaps did not have the same level of internet, or maybe at home did not have the same level of internet, we were starting to introduce a different level of inequity that we never had to deal with before, because within the closed campus environment, we have done a lot to kind of equalize the playing field.
Every organization I speak with essentially has a cloud-first strategy. But the reality is hybrid, right? So there's cloud-first, and I've also heard cloud-smart, where many of the states, some of the federal agencies are starting to pursue this cloud-smart, which is cloud where it makes sense, or cloud where there's mission capabilities to support. What's your perspective on kind of the hybrid environment and what you see within higher education?
I think increasingly looking for capabilities to move workloads between different cloud providers. And also recognizing that, the cloud is not a uniform concept, right? And there's a real difference between SaaS, PaaS, IaaS, and really being cognizant of that. And in some ways, I think, it's really kind of important to think through what is the workload that you're trying to move into the cloud and which cloud provider is best suited for it. The hybrid cloud strategy is a more common approach.
Not every cloud service provider delivers the same type of innovation and for the same type of workload or the same type of mission. And so I think it's really critically important that customers look at the right cloud provider for the right mission, the right workload, and then secondarily, to make sure that there's integration, there's security, there's identity, there's privacy, there's all these components, kind of another layer. And you have IaaS, PaaS, you have SaaS, but you also have this kind of fourth dimension, which is security around the whole thing, right? And ensuring that there's connectivity. And so I think it's really important for customers to think about an enterprise identity, privacy, security strategy to connect both cloud and on-prem, so kind of the hybrid as well as multi-cloud approach. So thoughts on that?
I wonder if people's computation of risk is changing after the SolarWinds incident, right? Because there was this kind of a control point, right, where we thought, okay, so these are the applications we run on-prem, we manage the perimeter, right? And there are two important things that have happened. One was SolarWinds and all of us having to now deal with third-party risk, even if you are running it on-prem, right? And third-party risks are very complicated. And once you really think about third-party risks on-prem, it's not that different from your third-party risks in the cloud, right? And the second thing is people went, right? So all of a sudden, the perimeter that people had in their mind, right, the network perimeter, that all went out the window, quite frankly, right? I mean, yes, you can have VPN solutions, et cetera, but this new way of working that is much more blended, that is really, I think, going to be difficult for people to continue to think that there's such a big difference between the security mindset that you need to have for things that you're hosting on-prem versus things that are in cloud, that are hosted in the cloud.
We spend thousands and thousands and thousands of man hours on security within our cloud to make sure that our customers are safe. And we want our customers to understand that we bring a tremendous amount of value in that security. In fact, more secure in many cases likely, and it's some debate, I think, people will debate the point, but more secure than an on-prem environment, right? To a very sophisticated attack.
One of the elements, and this can get very complicated in higher education, is the whole data lifecycle management. And whether or not it's research data or even all of university data, right? And you know, sometimes when people think about kind of solutions around, you know, where to host their data, they're thinking about, you know, the storage, right? But they're also, there's also the data management enablement that is really, really important. And, you know, that, if I remember correctly, is another place where you guys have solutions, right?
It is, absolutely. And in fact, so I always say, you know, Oracle, it's SaaS, PaaS, and IaaS. Our SaaS runs on our OCI, which is our Oracle Cloud infrastructure. We have premise-based capabilities. We have cloud-based capabilities. So sort of deployment model choice. But in the end, ultimately, whether you're running in the cloud or you're running on-prem, it's enterprise data management. And when I think about data management, cloud and on-prem, and I think about statutory requirements, and I think about data lifecycle, I think deeply about data ownership. Who owns the data?
You know, Pat, when you mentioned sensor data, I think one of the things, you were talking earlier about identity, right? And I think that in that another interesting element there is machine identities, right? So, you know, a lot of the time we have always thought about identity being associated with a person, right? But we have, you know, with AI, you know, robotic process automation, et cetera, increasingly we are granting identities to things that are not human yet, right? Right? So, right? And so being able to manage that, right?
Yeah.
Being able
yeah.
to manage machine identities or identities of, you know, robotic, you know, AI processes. I think that's another space, I think, that will require a different level of identity proofing and identity vetting than what we had thus far. But when you think about ML and what is happening just in enterprise platforms, right, with machine learning, you know, again, you know, robotic RPA, et cetera, that is actually an incredibly rapidly developing space. And that, you know, in many ways, a space where Oracle is developing quite a bit of capability.
That's why I think Oracle starts with enterprise data management, because once you have that enterprise data management layer, the insights that you glean from the data is what creates value. The data itself, you know, inherently doesn't contain value. It's just zeros and ones or whatever, but it's the insight that you can glean and the innovation that you can introduce into your business based upon those insights.
As you very correctly point out, the kind of the data layer is the core layer, right? Because nobody wants to be spending time trying to, you know, merge the data together, right? And, you know, you can see a not so distant future, a place where, you know, bringing the data together can be more increasingly automated.
I'd like to conclude with another personal item, which is equity, diversity, and inclusion. What's your perspective on equity, diversity, and inclusion within education, and where do you think we are on that journey now?
Out of the sale of edX to you, there's a new nonprofit that is being stood up to really look at, amongst other things, how to make education more inclusive, how to make the opportunities more broadly available. Incredible amount of energy, but also vision is going into that. But I think we need to realize that the reason why United States has over 5,000 institutions is because it is not the role of one institution to educate everybody, but it is the vibrancy of the ecosystem that has made education such an equalizer, right? And so I sometimes worry a little bit about the mantra of, you know, universities are going to go out of business, et cetera, because when you're thinking about a career that a person has, and especially people that are coming out of school now, they're going to need to refresh their skills every 6 to 10 years and potentially completely switch careers. I see actually more demand for education in the future rather than less demand for education. So there are going to be degrees, there are going to be educational opportunities, there are going to be vendor-specific trainings, right? And I think how we think about that in a more holistic way versus, you know, either or, I think is where there's more thinking that is needed. Just because it is very, very clear that without a lifelong education and a lifelong commitment to refresh of skills, it is going to be difficult to not end up in a situation of haves and have-nots and areas where people are left behind.
Very optimistic about the future of education, very optimistic about the future of technology, and exceedingly optimistic about how those two things coalesce to create a better outcome for folks.
Universities are in the business of creation, preservation of knowledge. That's what we do, right? And as a society, we are facing increasing levels of threats. Being able to engage with students on how you create knowledge, how you curate information, what are trusted forces, sources, what are not, how do you create a full picture of knowledge is a tremendous opportunity for universities, and it's going to be an educational space that where we have the opportunity to really contribute in a very meaningful way.
Very insightful conversation. I really appreciate the time, as well as your partnership, and definitely look forward to working with you in the near future, Clara. Thank you.
Absolutely, Pat. And I hope that at some point, maybe in the summer, we will get to walk around Harvard Yard together and actually, you know, talk in person.
I'm betting on it. Thank you so much. Okay, take care. Bye.
Bye.